Good morning, St. James. Good morning. Won't you join me on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer, the purple book with the cross in your pew. Join me on page 355, and when we pray our collect together, you'll find that in the center of your bulletin. Page 355. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins, and his mercy endures forever. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray today's collect together. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversaries which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of our lessons.
A reading from Exodus. Then God spoke all these words: I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord. We will read responsively Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard, in the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course. The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent. The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous together, altogether. By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward. Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over them, over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense. Glory to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
A reading from Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, O Christ.
The Passover was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables, making a whip of cords. He drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." They said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." They said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. In the gospel reading this morning, we see the expression of Jesus' zeal for God displayed in a way that some people don't understand because they don't know the true multifaceted nature of Jesus. In looking at this passage, let's gain a better idea of this zeal and how to model our behavior as Christians, aiming to be a reflection of Jesus and his character. According to the Gospel Coalition, zeal in Christianity is a burning desire to please God, to do his will, and to advance his glory in the world in every possible way. It is a desire which is not natural to men and women. According to Merriam-Webster, zeal is eagerness, an ardent interest in the pursuit of something fervent. Among the spiritual gifts Paul lists in Romans 12 are dedicated service, sincere love, evil is to be hated, and good should be clung to tightly. There's to be a mutual honoring of devotion to one another. All these are noble purposes that become a reality to us as we practice them out of our deep devotion to Christ. Now, what is Jesus like? Some people think of Jesus as a baby, lying in a manger, surrounded by animals, shepherds, and wise men, because that's what was presented to them through their Christmas tradition. Others have heard more about him, know he grew up to be a man, but the stories they heard about him have led them to conclude that he was so loving, tender, and mild, and this would lead them to assume that Jesus would never get angry, raise his voice, or stand in open opposition of anyone. They think of him as a religious reformer, using passive resistance and compassionate miracles to bring about change that's needed. Jesus is often thought of, and even proclaimed to be, the ultimate example of tolerance. According to the scriptures, there's truth in describing Jesus with the character of a meek and mild lamb. However, the view of Jesus as never getting angry and always being passive gives us a false impression of him. This is not the Jesus who came to earth to redeem us from our sins. Why was Jesus so angry in this passage? His disciples remind us to remember that it was written in Psalm 69:9, "Zeal for thy house will consume me." It is true that Jesus was kind and offered forgiveness to the humble, regardless of their sin, such as the woman who was caught in adultery in John 8. However, it is also true that Jesus was quick to oppose those who were spiritually proud and pronounce woes upon them and even call them names. His condemnation of the scribes and Pharisees in Matthew 23 is a good example. Among the names that Jesus used to describe them in that passage are hypocrites, blind guides, fools, serpents, brood of vipers, sons of hell sentenced to hell. Now, would you describe that as being passive and tolerant? Let's also consider what Jesus tells us in John 14:6. "I am the way, the truth, and the light. No one comes to the Father but through me." This declaration is very intolerant of any other religious viewpoint. Jesus associates his zeal with God, with his Father, the Father's temple. He was committed to the cause of God, and it took up, it consumed his energy, his time, and his thoughts. His actions were directed toward the work of the kingdom of God. As Christians, we should strive for that zeal for God. After all, God took us when we were dead in our transgressions and sin and made us alive in Christ. Unfortunately, most professing Christians separate their religious life from their everyday life. Jesus is Lord on Sunday morning through Sunday's benediction, but is given little thought during the rest of the week until we come back on Sunday again. There's a time and place for Christians to be angry and move to strong actions. When those feelings result from a zeal from God, it is anger the godly have when they hear someone claiming to be a Christian, but they are openly living an ungodly life. It's anger the godly have
when they hear someone perverting the scriptures. It is anger the godly have when they hear the beautiful name of the Lord being used in vain. When God's glory and honor are at stake, we as Christians can boldly declare with responsibility and discernment the truth without consideration of other people's feelings. Anger is often the result of a bad decision. Anger is not the problem. It's how our emotions let us know that something is wrong. Anger in its right place can get things done. Ephesians 4:26 tell us, in your anger, do not sin. We also should not let anger control our emotions, because emotions left to themselves don't have intellect. In other words, we don't have the faculties or the capacity of reasoning and understanding objectively. But righteous anger brings about righteous change. Mother Teresa, Gandhi, Martin Luther King Jr., and Jesus all achieve things through righteous anger. Some people will try to push you around and push your buttons. They want to bring you to their level of anger. But as people of faith, we are called to rise above that. Try responding rather than reacting, and work toward talking it out in the calmest possible way. If you lead with kindness and it fails, try not to take it too personal. Most of the time, anger comes from our desire to control things. But if we trust God, then the control belongs to Him. Why was Jesus so angry? Because the temple was supposed to be the place where those who did not know God could learn of Him and be instructed and how to worship. It was supposed to be the place where the worship of God was highlighted before the unbelieving so that they might believe. It was where the godly could worship the true God, but instead it became a pagan temple. The worship of God had been turned into a money-making venture in His house. They had taken a place intended for worship and turned it into a marketplace. The selling of animals in itself was fine, because people traveling from far away needed to purchase animals to offer as their sacrifice. But Jesus called it a den of thieves because they were charging exorbitant prices and lining their pockets at the expense of the worshipers. And they were in the outer court of the temple, where people should have been worshiping. Jesus was zealous for the reverence due to God the Father. He knew they would not clear out of the temple without force, so He made the whip to chase them out of the temple, His Father's house. The religious leaders turned it into a place of business and of money-making. They put a price on what God intended to be free. Jesus knew that access to God was not for sale. Recall that at Jesus' death, the veil in the Holy of Holies in the temple was torn from the top down to the bottom. The final sacrifice had been paid, and man could now approach God through Christ instead of the temple sacrificial system, which was in place at that time. When Jesus chased them out of the temple, they demanded to know who gave Him the authority to chase them out. In other words, they wanted to know, how do we say it, who died and left you in charge? Jesus' reply was, destroy this temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. They assumed He was talking about the building He had just chased them out of. But He was speaking about the temple of His body. The disciples didn't comprehend what He said either at that time. It required Jesus' resurrection for them to grow in their faith and understanding. His resurrection would indeed demonstrate his authority for cleansing the temple. After Jesus' resurrection, the disciples remembered what he had said, and at that time they understood it. Jesus was who he claimed to be. He is the Messiah, the Son of God, who redeemed mankind with his own resurrection, an offer of eternal life to those who believe in him. We are not to be passive wimps or tolerate any and everything. We are to be a loving people, meek, gentle, and kind. But at the same time, we are to have a zeal, a fire for God that could also be described as being consuming. The godly are to have zeal for all that is associated with God. There's to be fervent devotion to him, passionate commitment to him, and jealousy for upholding his righteous character. Zeal carries you that extra step to continue the pursuit when others would have quit. It moves you to act when others are pensive and fearful. It keeps you focused on what is readily important in life rather than you being distracted. Zeal should be a characteristic of all of our lives. Jesus' anger was based on his zeal for the Lord. Where do you stand? Let us all think of our path to demonstrate our zeal for Christ with these as considerations. Do you have zeal for God? Are you consumed with him? What are you committed to? Do you have a desire to worship him? Do you serve him with intensity and consistency? Are you living for him so that your life is seen in terms of glorifying him? Let us pray for our help to come as we go about our Father's work. Holy and gracious God, speak to our hearts and minister to us in grace. Please send your Holy Spirit to help us demonstrate this life we have in Christ. Give us eyes to see the needs of others. Give us a heart that is burdened to help others. And give us hands to serve our neighbors by walking boldly and joyfully with them, to bless their lives with the good works you have created in us to do. And it's in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we ask these things. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Aronde. Won't you please affirm the words of this great message that we heard with the words of the Nicene Creed by turning to page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer, page 358, where we affirm our faith. Let us pray together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We're coming now with the prayers of our people, which you'll find in the bulletin printed this morning. And let us please offer Shirley Bryce's name for our persons in need of prayer.
Prayers of the people. For the peace of the world, for the welfare of the Holy Church of God, and for the unity of all peoples, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for our bishops and for all the clergy and people, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for our president, for the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority, let us pray to the Lord. For the Baltimore metro area, for every city and community, and for those who live in them, let us pray to the Lord. For the good earth which God has given us, and for the wisdom and will to conserve it, let us pray to the Lord. For the aged and infirm, for the widowed and orphans, and for the sick and the suffering, we pray for Vashti Christmas, Luther Day, Barbara Dunson, Rosie Hutchinson, Edna May Greer, Calvin Holly, Roosevelt Johnson, Holly Megginson, Mercedes Mitchie, Mildred Parrott, Howard Saunders III, Marion Slocum, Evangeline Stewart, Janice Sidnor, and Wendy Taylor. Let us pray to the Lord. For the poor and the oppressed, for the unemployed and the destitute, for prisoners and captives, and for all who remember and care for them, let us pray to the Lord. For all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, and for all the departed, such as Thelma, Moore, let us pray to the Lord. For deliverance from all danger, violence, oppression, and degradation, let us pray to the Lord. That we may end our lives in faith and hope without suffering and without reproach, let us pray to the Lord. Defend us, deliver us, and in thy compassion protect us, O Lord, by the grace.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, in the glory of your name. Amen.
Good morning, St. James, and happy World Mission and Giving Sunday. If you would take your seats, please be reminded that we welcome your $3 to $5 donation for our annual give to the Water of South Sudan. So there are purple envelopes for your donations. Thank you to all the members who made last Sunday a special occasion at the historic St. James, for worshiping as one to Soul Food Sunday. So by applause, let me know if you ate good and your belly was full when you left. And keep that applause going for the many hands who planned and executed another successful event. February was quite a month for us, beginning with our traditional candle mass service, and you will see highlights in the upcoming e-news. On Palm Sunday, March 24th, the Baltimore Community Concert Choir will present Hosanna in the Highest right here at 4 p.m. If you would like to be a concert patron, you may remit your $10 via the plate or push pay. Remember, this is a non-ticketed event, but you should plan to arrive early. Easter Lily envelopes are available in the narthex. Your donations will be used to adorn our altar on Easter Sunday. I am hopeful that our middle and high school students are downstairs participating in their Lenten book study. This will run each Sunday during the month of March. I hope you are getting excited as we continue to move closer to the 200th anniversary Jubilee celebration. So there will be a special announcement on Sunday, March 10th. Now, I know we have some special guests that you'll meet shortly, but if this is your first time visiting St. James, would you please stand and give us your name and maybe where you're visiting from? Any first-time visitors? Okay. Outside of our special guests. All right. Well, I will now call Mrs. Nicole Jones. We'll get to you later. I'll call Ms. Nicole Jones, who will lead in our Giving Sunday presentation.
morning, St. James.
Good morning.
As your outreach director, I have the distinct pleasure of welcoming you to World Mission and Giving Sunday. This Sunday is dedicated to extending our support to our World Mission organization, as well as pouring into our community organizations in support of the good work that they do. Our church continues to be able to help community organizations, so it's wonderful that today we can give, not just ask for money. We have chosen three wonderful organizations to contribute to. We will be providing each organization with a check in the amount of $500. The three organizations that have been chosen this year are as follows. Our first organization, Black Girls Vote. Black Girls Vote has been working hard to inspire, engage, and educate young women to become the voice of our political landscape by exercising their right to vote. They continue to reach women of color because they know that our voice and our vote can push policy and elected leaders to represent our issues. They are a national, nonpartisan, nonprofit organization with a community that inspires Black girls to use the political process to improve the quality of life for their families and the community as whole. The founder, Nikki Robinson, launched Black Girls Vote on November 30th, 2015, the birthday of Shirley Chisholm, the first Black woman elected to the United States Congress. And just as Shirley Chisholm did, Nike seeks to bring the change through advocacy, outreach, and building our strength in numbers, which reflects the core of the purpose of Black Girls Vote. Accepting the contribution will be Yolanda Winkler, the treasurer for Black Girls Vote. Can you come to the front? Words?
Sure. Thank you so much. First of all, I want to say good morning to the St. James Episcopal Church family. Happy Women's History Month. I want to first give honor to my Savior, Jesus Christ, who woke me up this morning, enabling me to continue to be a living testimony for what he is doing and continue to do in my life and those around me. I want to thank the leadership here at St. James, led by Father Meadows, and I want to thank your outreach director, Sister Nicole Jones, who saw it not robbery to make a donation to an organization founded in November 2015 by God-fearing leader, Nikedra Robinson. And as she sought to ensure her vision was sustainable, she connected God with God and other God-fearing women, of which I was one, to be on her executive board. Black Girls Vote, Inc. is a nonpartisan organization that informs, engages, and empowers individuals through awareness of their voting privileges and rights with a keen focus on women, children, and families, issues locally, statewide, and nationally. And for those that may not know, we have 8 collegiate chapters throughout the country. Thank you. There is much information about us that can be found at blackgirlsvote.com. Now I leave you with this scripture, Philippians 2, verses 3 through 4. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Mr. Howard. Thank you. Thank you so much. Beautiful words. Thank you.
Our second organization, the B.org. At the B.org, their mission is to encourage and nurture youth to live above their social imposed limitations, to develop their character, talents, and leadership skills, allowing them to go beyond a dream and achieve remarkable excellence. Their programs are centered around social emotional learning, STEM, and college readiness. Social emotional learning is the process through which people acquire and effectively apply the knowledge, attitudes, and skills necessary to understand and manage emotions, set and achieve positive goals, feel and show empathy for others, establish and maintain positive relationships, and make responsible decisions. The B.org works to keep science, technology, engineering, and math, STEM, principles, topics, and teachings at the forefront of their programmatic efforts to ensure students not only are exposed to STEM, but empowers them to know their unique brilliance and passions and have rightful place in the industry. In addition, their volunteer college support team hosts workshops and one-on-one sessions that help with completing the FAFSA application, understanding the financial aid process, and assisting with college applications and essays. Accepting the contribution is Tony Lawson, founder and executive director of the B.org.
Amen.
Good morning, St. James. I want to first give honor to God and just full glory to him for even allowing me to be here today and to have the vision to be able to serve. We are celebrating 10 years of the B.org this year. Thank you. And so I'll give a quick story where we started. We were working with my sorority, all of my sorors here today, and we were supporting some youth at the Seed School of Maryland. We had a program for leadership development for 120 students, and they saw something in me and my leadership skills that said, Tony, you should start a nonprofit. And I was like, this is not a part of my plan. What are you talking about? But when people see things in you that you may not see in yourself, you have to take heed and you listen to that. And so here we are 10 years later. At that time, also, there was one of the young ladies, and she was struggling with the transition to middle school. And she ended up saying that no one from Baltimore ever makes it. And my heart broke for her in that moment, that she felt like she was unworthy of success. And so that, coupled with my sorors encouraging me, we have gone on to serve over 3,000 youth in the last 10 years. I'm sorry, y'all, it's been a long week from CIAA. But yes, many more to come. And we also are in 8 schools around the city and in Baltimore County as well. So we serve several hundred students a year, and just so very appreciative of the support and the leadership here for St. James to help us continue out our mission. So thank you so much.
Welcome. And we're going to take a picture. Thank you so much. What a wonderful story, too.
All right, the last organization is Level 82, co-founded by former Baltimore Ravens Torrey Smith and his lovely wife, Chanel, Level 82 strives to create a gathering space for those who live, work, and play in Baltimore City while developing strategically curated programming to empower the community. Aligned with the mission to leverage the power of collaboration to enable families to reach their full potential, Tori and Chanel bring their own personal partnerships with Baltimore City Recreation and Parks. The Hilton Recreation Center hosts Level 82 programs, including academic support, athletic and enrichment activities, mental health resources, and social services. Together, they create a more equitable society that we all deserve, want, and need. Also, in honor of Tori's late brother, Tevin Jones, Level 82 awards 4 annual college scholarships to high school seniors. Recipients of the scholarship are awarded $10,000, distributed over 4 years. On a personal note, Tori and Chanel have both been great sources of support for my family in 2014 with the sudden loss of my then 7-year-old cousin. She was an avid Tori Smith fan. They were very supportive to my cousin, helping her deal with the loss of her daughter. Tori couldn't be here to accept this contribution, but we will mail it to the organization. Now getting to World Mission Sunday. We have been celebrating World Mission Sunday at St. James for the last 10 years. We have given to Heifer International, assistance to Virgin Islands in the wake of Hurricane Maria, and water for South Sudan. The Outreach Committee has decided we will maintain our relationship with the Water for South Sudan by once again making our annual donation. We have contributed over $1,000 so far. So your $3 to $5 or more will help our brothers and sisters in South Sudan. Today, when you turn on your faucet in your home or flush your toilet, stop and think how fortunate you are and how you can help someone in a distant land experience some of the basic conveniences of life. It's true, in giving, you also receive. And if you look in your insert in the call, you will see all of the organizations that we have previously submitted donations to. Thank you.
Thank you to Nicole and the committee for all of the great work that you do, and to our guests who have come just to receive these gifts. We just honor you and thank you for all that you do. Are there any prayers? Anyone in need of prayers for birthday, traveling, or anniversaries? Anyone? Marianne is coming. Oh, okay. All right. Birthday. Birthday and travel. Birthday and you both traveling. Birthday right here in the middle. Dottie, come on around. Birthday, Dottie's birthday. Mrs. Lambert, you all can kind of spread so people can see you. Come on around, come on around. There we go. All of these birthdays, God has given each of you, I say this many times, God has given each of you to this church as a gift. And our prayer for you is that God will allow you to continue your gift for many, many, many more years. He has blessed you with health and strength and marvelous gifts and determination and confidence and commitment and the gift and an anointing of fresh wind. And so, God, I ask that you keep them on their journey, that you give them the resources they need to complete the work at hand, that they lack nothing in their lives, and that their strength is increased 100-fold, that they may continue to move about your people, sharing and giving and loving and allowing others to experience the wonderful love and the gift that they have. Let them not run out of energy. Let them not run out of money. And most of all, let them not run out of love. But bless them continuously, continuously, continuously. And we will thank you, thank you, thank you. In Jesus' name, happy birthday to all of you. God bless you. God bless you. Amen. Amen. And you're traveling, and Nicole's traveling. Come a little closer. Alvin, you're going on a cruise. I knew it was something. Thank you, Jesus. A cruise for your wife's birthday. And you're you just going to, you won't save journey. We wish it was a cruise. Yeah. Gracious God, as they take to the sky and to the sea and to the land, God, as they travel, give mercy, traveling mercies and grace to them. Allow your angels, the hosting angels and the ministering angels, to be on either side of them, forward and back. Protect them from all evil, protect them from the enemy, but most of all, protect them from the world that would envelop them and take them away. And so God, bless them, keep them, strengthen them. Let this be a joyous journey. Let them find new love and new fellowship and new peace among themselves, so that you will know, that they will know that you are with them and you will never leave them nor forsake them. Safe journey in Jesus' name, amen. We love you, we love you, love you, love you. Amen, amen. With all that we've done today, we have a call to action. And so I want you to hear these words for a few minutes. Our own Mrs. Baum is coming to express all that you've heard in this world giving and outreach. She's coming now. And then I want you to walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and a sacrifice unto God, after the words of Marsha Baum.
God bless you. Good morning, St. James family. I'm honored to stand before you today sharing words that God asked me to share with his beloved children of the historic and highly favored St. James. Please join me in imagining this miraculous scene. Most were not present when it happened, but the reports flew swiftly around the community. At the stroke of 9 p.m., on a clear summer evening, a stream of brilliant, multicolored, laser-like lights could be seen shooting straight up into the air. Residents around the park quickly realized the fantastic light show was happening in the middle of Lafayette Square Park and gathered to watch in awe. The lights were shooting up from the ground, not a hole in the ground, but shooting straight upwards from an unknown source on the ground. As the neighbors watched with mouths open and disbelief on their faces, they saw an even more shocking, unimaginable scene. Five black women, dressed not in clothing of this time, suddenly appeared from next to the shooting lights. One minute not there, the next, there they stood, in long black dresses, capes, and wearing matching church hats, gazing back at the neighbors with what could only be described as heavenly smiles on their faces. Immediately, without truly understanding why, the gathered neighbors fell to their knees in deference and honor to these women they didn't know, didn't understand how and why they were there, but the neighbors understood in their hearts that they were in the presence of God-sent miracles and wonder. These five black women are part of a heavenly group that God has praying day and night for St. James. Prayers for the building up and sustaining of a church structure. Prayers for godly, holy men to lead the congregations. Prayers for the community members in need to know that God saw them, cared for them, and loved them with a lavish, never-failing love. Prayers for the resources and funds to keep the good work of St. James flowing nonstop. And prayers of praise and worship to the loving God who brought forth, lifted up, and keeps watch over the historic and highly favored St. James. God allowed the five women to return to the church home and community that each of their sons led with distinction. These women are the mothers of William Levington, George Bragg, Cedric Mills, Donald Wilson, and Michael Curry, esteemed former founders and priests of St. James. The mothers who prayed them into the positions of leadership and advocacy they obtained, prayed for their sons to be allowed to live and lead and not be harmed by white folks who refused to see beyond their prejudice and hate for God's black children. Prayed also for their sons to not be harmed by free blacks who questioned whether enslaved blacks should be allowed to worship alongside free blacks. And they continued to pray that the foundations their precious sons laid at St. James and in the community would remain constant. As the neighbors watched in astonishment and followed, the five women began to walk the neighborhood slowly and carefully, taking it all in. They see the trash and papers that litter the space where their prayers, that litter the space their prayers obtained for the church and the surrounding streets. They see the balloons, teddy bears, and candles that adorn some doorways and corners, and know that they are not there in celebration of a birthday, but as a memorial to mark the spot where a loved one was murdered. They see the faces, young and old, lined with despair, distrust, and hopelessness. They see the living monuments, stiff as stone and leaning, some almost touching their knees with their faces, leaned down from the effects of the drugs they consume, trying to dull the pain, anger, and hurt that runs deep inside them. The mothers of great leaders also see bodies lying prone in the dirt and trash, with people moving quickly by, sometimes even stepping over the prone bodies in their path, not knowing if they are breathing or are already on their way home to God. The five black ancestral mothers see and hear the noise and empty promises of elected leaders who turn closed eyes and ears to the scenes of inhumanity in the spaces they are supposed to govern. As the mothers walked in silence, observing the community, which others use words like poverty-stricken, blighted, crime-ridden, dangerous, and violent to describe, the neighbors following them were astounded to see the same heavenly smiles on their faces. The heavenly, unworried eyes of these five mothers saw what we often miss. The five black mothers saw that the Lafayette Square Neighborhood Association keeps the park clean and offers events for residents to gather in community. That Father Meadows pays to have the church property and nearby properties picked up of trash and harmful instruments. They recognize that for our neighbors afflicted with substance abuse, other loving neighbors are caring for them, making sure they don't fall from the nod and hurt themselves, or keeping close watch on those lying prone to make sure they are still breathing and not in need of an ambulance. They see the memorials to those shot down and praise God that someone cared for them, loved them, and are sorrowful at their death. All God's children matter. The mothers walk by Harlan Park School, clasp hands, and say a special prayer reserved for those that care for the youngest and most precious of God's children, educating them so that they too will see themselves in their community with eyes that see the good and the blessings, not just the negativity too often heaped unfairly and arrogantly upon the people and community. The five black mothers return and stop in the street between the church and the parish center. There is a large crowd of neighbors following them. The mothers ask those present to please take a hand and make a circle, and without question, they do. They ask the crowd of neighbors to join them in lifting praise and thanks to Father Meadows for his leadership, faith, and love for God and people. They are particularly pleased that he is carrying on the legacy their sons began. The mothers give thanks to the vestry and the congregation for the effective and monumental work they are doing, not just inside the building, but more importantly, the work on the outside, in community. The congregation of St. James is following the teachings of Jesus to love our neighbors as ourselves. The large crowd listens quietly and holds hands tightly as the five black mothers share with them and God what they have witnessed and know. The mothers praise the church for their generosity in supporting the initiatives of community organizations locally and globally. They raise their hands in thanksgiving for the vital twice monthly food distributions that are feeding God's children in West Baltimore. Coordinator Angie Cornish, a dedicated volunteer, is making sure St. James is doing what Jesus told the disciples to do, feed my sheep. The mothers offer appreciation that with generosity and love, a place was made in the parish center for St. Luke's youth programming, and that there is a collaborative, strong relationship with Harlem Park Elementary Middle School. The five black mothers clapped their hands in praise to Elise Jude Mason and the St. James Archives Committee for the stellar, detailed work in researching and preserving the history of St. James. The historic and exceptional accomplishments and success of St. James is an extraordinary story that must be known and told. The five black mothers raised their hands and voices toward heaven and thanked their father for the 200 years of excellence, perseverance, and strong guiding faith that he has blessed St. James with, and asked their father to continue to lift up and maintain the existence and work of the historic St. James First African Protestant Episcopal Church. As the last prayer ends, the five black mothers walk toward the sacred space where they arrived. The large crowd has grown, and neighbors are carrying candles, flowers, tree branches. Some are holding their Bibles high, and most have tears of joy and love streaming down their faces. They understand they have witnessed a miracle, a godly arranged visitation and light show that they were blessed to see. Most will never be the same, and will take the magic of what they witnessed and use it to do good works in their community throughout the city of Baltimore and beyond. Many will join the congregation at St. James, understanding now that St. James is a special place, a holy place, a place where good works are done in the name of God. As the five black mothers left, as mysteriously as they appeared, the heavenly beautiful shooting lights continued until daybreak, ending as suddenly as they began. As we celebrate the 200th anniversary of St. James, we should also be praying for it and buoyed by what the next 200 years will bring. We can thank God that the five black mothers will be praying with us. Black Granny reminds in each talk that hashtag God loves black women. Goodbye.
Thank you.
dedicate this Eucharistic prayer to the health and healing of our dear sister Shirley Bryce. We also dedicate this Eucharistic prayer to Thelma Moore, a former member of our church who died the past week. So God bless them. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was tempted in every way as we are, yet did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with James and the beloved Mary and all of your saints, we may enter into the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Thank you. Before we go to our post-communion prayer, I just wanted you to know that on March the 16th, we will be holding our leadership summit. Many of you have received invitations, but this is open to all true believers. We will be talking about some very important points concerning church growth, church finances, and we are asking all of you to that are interested, and those of you who desire, that you will be there on the 16th. And I will also be sharing a spiritual vision for the future of our congregation. So we're asking all to attend. On this coming Friday, Thelma Moore's funeral, sort of like a repass funeral type conversation, will be over in the Parish Center at 12 noon on Friday. And for anyone who is interested, who has never been confirmed, adult or children, we will be having confirmation classes. There's a notice in the narthex. You can pick that up on your way out. So please be alert of these very important happenings in our church, especially on the 16th. March 8th is the last day of registration for that, so please contact our committee and our office if you are interested in being there, led by our strategic planning committee. Won't you join me on page 365 for our post-communion prayer? Lay readers and acolytes, please meet Mr. Gibson Saturday at 9 a.m. and join us for coffee across the street right after service. So let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God our Savior be glory and majesty, dominion and power both now and ever. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn. Thank you.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.